Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
If we can please stand as we enter the throne room of grace and mercy.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, for a beautiful day. Yes, Lord, as we prepare our hearts and our minds for the purpose of this day, let us go to God the Father who planned this day before time began. Lord, we thank you for this day one more time, God. Lord, this special day, God, when the glory of sin became the glory of redemption. Thank you, Lord God. God, we thank Jesus for his obedience. He prayed the night before to get this cup taken from him. But no, he knew he had to go through because mankind, he was determined to do because we depend on it. Thank you, Lord, for sending your son Jesus, who shed his precious blood for us, that we may be in eternity with him forever, and that sin and the devil are defeated for eternity, God.
Glory.
They have no more hold on this earth, God. And Lord, we pray that today, that someone, God, will give their life over to you, Lord, because that is the purpose for this day. We may go through celebration, we may go through all sorts, but the end of the day, it belongs to you. So we open this right now to all participants, everyone who will be praising your name, because you reign on high. You will continue to reign on high, and we give you thanks. The glory of the cross. The glory of the cross.
Hallelujah
for the glory of the cross. That we don't have to carry our cross, not to be sacrificed. Thank you, Lord, for everything you have done. And in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. What a beautiful day.
Yes.
To celebrate a day that didn't look that beautiful back then. Today, we can say it's a good Friday.
Oh, yes.
Jesus went to the cross. He hung, he bled, and he died. And he arose with all power in his wings.
Hallelujah.
Like a rose, he was trampled on the ground.
Oh, yes.
Hallelujah. But he came and took the fall and thought of us. And thought of us. Before we even existed, he thought of us. So today we're going to sing that. Above all, whatever is you're dealing with, think of Jesus above all. Think of what he did for you.
Yes, he did.
What are you now going to give to Jesus? Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Above all kingdoms.
saints.
Morning.
The Most High God. In a little town on the outskirts of a city, a man met a little boy with a cage full of birds. The man said, "What do you have there, sonny?" "Oh, I have a cage full of birds." So the man said, "Well, what are you going to do with them?" "Well, I'm going to tease them. I'm going to play with them. And then I'm going to kill every one of them." The man's heart was touched with compassion. "What would you take for them, sonny?" "And the boy there, I can make a killing." "Oh, it's going to be very expensive, sir." "What is your price?" He said, $5 apiece. So the man paid for the birds, and he took the birds up on a hill. He opened the cage, but the birds would not come out. They had been in the cage so long that they wouldn't come out. So he put his hands in there gently, and as the birds got on his arm, he took them out and said, "Little birdies, you are free because I paid the price. So come with me." Over 2,000 years ago, Jesus met Satan. And Jesus said, "Satan, what do you have there?" Satan said, "A world full of sinners." And Jesus said, "What are you going to do with them?" "Oh, I'm going to corrupt them, fill them up with the world, tease them, and then I'm going to kill every one of them." Jesus' heart was touched with compassion. "What would you take for them, Satan?" "Oh, they're no good. The thieves and whoremongers and liars and cheaters. You don't want them." Jesus said, "What's the price?" "Well, if you want them, it's going to be very expensive. In fact, it's going to cost you blood, sweat, and tears. In fact, it's going to cost your very life." And Jesus said, "Okay, you have a deal. But you meet me at noonday on Golgotha's Hill, the place called Calvary." And as Jesus hung and bled and died, a sinless man gave his life for countless sinners. And today we are free because Jesus paid the price.
I am free, you are free, because Jesus, anybody glad if Jesus paid the price? Hallelujah. Oh, what a price, what a price. His very life. And that's why we stand here, we sit here today, grateful for the work that he has done. And that work keeps on giving. It's still efficient. It's still ever giving. And for that reason, we can never forget that Good Friday. And that's why we gather from generation to generation to esteem the work done on Calvary's Hill. Thank you, Mother De Silva. Beautifully done. Beautifully done. Amen. I greet you, church, in the precious name of Jesus, our Lord and our soon coming King. Grateful for today and what it means to the Christian, to the one that has accepted Jesus, that we shall never forget. I give you greetings in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Certainly to our Bishop, Jacqueline E. McCullough, we greet her in her absence, to Mom and Dad, and to everyone, those that may be viewing online, we greet you also. And today, on this Good Friday, we want to minister from the overall thought of the glory of the cross. Hey, the glory of the cross. It's still glorious, church. The glory of the cross.
Galatians 6 and 14. Here beginneth the word of God for now and throughout. Galatians 6, 14. But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. Church, our focus must always be Jesus and his work of completion. What must drive us is the truth of the gospel, that Jesus carried forth the work of redemption. Yes, Jesus agreed to walk in deglorified, my word, deglorified flesh state, so that he could walk in our weakened and demoralized estate, so that he could meet us where we are and then take us back to where he came from. Yes, Jesus the Son is a part of the Trinity. There is God the Father, God the Son, Jesus, and then God the Holy Spirit. In agreement and oneness, the Godhead headed to the earth to win back those who fell with the first Adam in the Garden of Eden. Hence, it was the second Adam in the Garden of Gethsemane who willingly accepted the full weight of the cup. The cup had no glory in it. Jesus had no glory in it. Nothing that you will desire it. No. The cup was full of iniquity and sin, the sin of humanity. The cup was stained with the increased leaven of sin. And I dare say the cup has gotten larger. Habashe, as time continued. Jesus walked the earth. Jesus won the hearts of mankind. Jesus worked wonders, signs, and miracles. Jesus is the one who won. Jesus won the victory for you and me. Jesus went through being wounded, whipped, and worse. And he did so that you and I, when we go through the same, we will do so by the power of the name of Jesus. When we go through, you're not alone. We're not alone. We do so by the power of the name of Jesus. In this way, the child of God is to live in victory. Come on, somebody. Am I saying that we're not going to go through? Oh, we're going to go through. But because Jesus won the cup, because Jesus won the victory, whatever we go through knowing that the end of it is victory. Church. There is a reason that we are warned not to glory for the sake of glory. In other words, we do not take the credit. We do not look at the work of Jesus as if it is our personal testimony, as if Jesus is our personal whipping boy savior. It even means the Christian can't take Good Friday for granted. It even means the Christian can't just say, oh, well, it's just Good Friday. No. This is the major moment. This is the moment for which he was born in a manger. My. No, church. We must always stand amazed at the work of the cross. It is glorious. My God. Now, the word glory comes from the Hebrew word kakonchemai. And it means, I'm only saying it once, and it means to boast, joy, rejoice. We are warned in the chapter, watch it now, not to boast on things that we can do. How dare I or any boast as if our blood can make clean the sin-filled bloodline of any person? How dare I or any boast as if I have done any work that could save any people now or later? How dare I or any boast as if we existed in the beginning and as if we had a conversation with God the Father, the Son, and laid the plan of salvation? No, wrong, never. If we are to glory, if we are to rejoice, if we are to boast, let it be that our firm focus is on Jesus as we bless his name and his work, and as we stand in humble adoration of a God who will consider mankind worthy of salvation. You know, what's the reason that you can and you ought not stay in your downtrodden state? Because there was a day when Jesus, what? He was on the cross and he carried every sin, sickness, and disease upon him so that when we go through, we will go through and not stay in. My aim, my focus, my commitment of worship is towards Jesus only and the glory work he did on the cross of Calvary, the cross of glory. What they saw as gory was concealed glory. I glory in nothing save the cross of Calvary. Jesus, glory to his name.
Lamb of God, by your precious spirit, you've come to destroy oppression and depression. It comes against the mind of the believer. You've come to bring joy where there's been sorrow. You've come in your peace, in your love, and in your acceptance.
to God. Oh, my God. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, God, we glorify you. Hallelujah. Thank you for your presence in this place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. The glory before. The glory before. St. John 17, 4, 5, and 24. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. Church, where two or three are gathered, there is the possibility of agreement and the possibility of a work being done. Now consider that the two and three that got together was the Godhead. Yee, glory to God. Hey, oh Lord. In unity and perfect agreement, my Lord, the plan was initiated and completed. The plan was decided and done. The plan was Alpha and Omega. The plan was the beginning and the end. The plan was the first and the last. See, we've got to get that. That when the plan was initiated in the mind of God, it was already done. So Jesus was working backwards from victory, as it were. Come on, scroll. This is so precious. For God will never lose, not ultimately. With one third of the angels defeated through disobedience, there will be sent the ultimate source to win back a people, the world, through obedience. That's what it is. Obedience is the challenge, you see. The challenge is not believing that there is a God. The challenge is not even believing that God sent his son. The challenge is in the obedience to the word of God, now that you know what you know. What we must appreciate fully is that before Jesus condescended and entered our fallen world, Jesus had divine glory. Jesus was divine glory. Jesus was glorious. Don't miss it. Before the foundation of the world, Jesus was glorious. And now this glory is different than any glory you or I can have. This glory comes from the Hebrew word doxa, and it means majesty, the kingly majesty which belongs to him as supreme ruler, majesty in the sense of the absolute perfection of a deity. It means majesty, the king, majesty of the Messiah. The absolutely perfect inward or personal excellency of Christ. A most glorious condition, most exalted state. See, that's why you can't give anybody else that glory. Not that glory. Jesus left all. He left all of this. He left the splendor of glory to come after us. Lord, have mercy. Huh? Anybody feeling kind of special right there? That before the foundation of the world, remember,
I said the plan was laid. It was already done. That in the completed mind of the Godhead, he already knew that in the year 2023, there would be a people who are still loving God, who are still worshiping God, who are determined to give God praise, to give God glory, to give God honor. He knew. He knew. The love of God, how rich, how pure, how measureless and strong. The perfect love of God caused the administration of heaven to convene a divine council meeting and conclude that it was now the time to have eternity condensed into time, to snatch humanity out of the clutches of sin and bring about reconciliation. Church, I want you to know that we have something majestic to look forward to. Oh, hallelujah. We have glory. Shebakata. Ooh, we have glory to look forward to. Streets of glory. Streets of glorious gold. Lord have mercy. I'll be walking on gold. A glorious time in glory. Hey, hey, hey. Don't worry if you can only afford a little car here. I said that you're going to be walking. This earth realm is nothing compared to glory. Listen here, we shall meet those who have died in Christ, and we shall have glorious praise and worship service. Church, do not allow this temporal world to deprive you of the sensibility of seeking the kingdom first. When you seek the kingdom first, you live this life to grow and mature from glory to glory so that one day you shall live in glory. See, I'm practicing down here. Lord, have mercy. That's why I show up. That's why I do what I do. I'm in practice mode. There we shall meet His Majesty, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who left glory and went back to glory. As Jesus traversed, covered the earth, He knew that His final abode would be glory. He knew that His final destination was not earth or the grave. No, 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 no. Jesus left glory, and Jesus was going back home to glory. It was on earth that Jesus prepared that He would return to glory. Watch this. It would not be empty-handed. No, no. He returned with the keys of life eternal. That's why you are guaranteed that if you know Jesus and if you have accepted Him as Savior, He has the key to your life now and He has the key to your life in eternity. He returned with eternal keys. The glory before was enough to keep Jesus focused while on earth. I think that the reason, Superintendent, many are not focused and they call themselves the church is because they're not focused on the glory that is to come. They're not focused on the sacrifice of the Son. But when you constantly understand what Jesus did, oh, you can't help but give Him glory. Yeah, yeah. And so Jesus, He kept the glory before Him. His sights were set. And may this same sight be yours. That you too will be focused, knowing that one day you shall see His glory and live in glory. The glory of mankind was lost, but no worries, no worries, no worries. Jesus will win it back.
That's the name of the Lord. The glory be gone. Genesis 3, 8 to 10. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Well, let's go back. Before Adam and Eve had no problem talking to God in the garden in their birthday suits, as some of us say. Why not? They were actually covered. They were covered by the presence of the glory of God. They had no need of nothing else. Because of sin that they had done, now they are hiding away from God. Can you imagine? They had truly fallen to think that they can hide from an all-seeing God.
Oh.
Verse 9 says, "And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? Does this remind you of you when you were children? We fought in Adam's shoes. We did something wrong. We went into hiding from our parents. In the closet, behind the curtain, under the bed, behind the couch.
Well.
We did not want to admit being wrong. We wanted to hide from the fact that we had done something wrong. We knew a cut behind was going to be for us for doing wrong. And we ran away from it." Verse 10 says, "And he said, I heard the voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and hid myself." Let's bring it up to today. The Christian comes to church and has a great time. Praise and worship is great. Enjoying themselves. The word of God is preached wonderfully by God's servant. The word hits the Christian right between the eyes. Now the Christian is upset at the pastor. The communication is broken down. Just like in the Garden of Eden, the person or persons no longer want to sit under the pastor's preaching or anyone's teaching. They have lost the glory they once knew. Their prior witness for God's brilliance and beauty is now a thing of the past. They want you to think that the pastor changed when it is them that have lost what they used to have. I repeat, Adam and Eve, some Christians today, have lost the glory they once knew. Glory be gone. Sin has disconnected Adam and Eve from God. When the glory is gone, God help us. Glory be gone.
Right out of the stop, sir. Yes,
sir. Adam and Eve, the fall. She blamed him. He wasn't there while she was searching him. Alone in the garden, browsing eyes again, feasting, forbidden thing, told to keep away from. Alluring be that serpent seeing her, away from him searching. Serpent slithers on in. Him off working, tilling, seeking, unseeing. He blamed her for being off and away searching. The forbidden thing. She blamed him for not being close enough and not listening in. While searching for you, in my view, the forbidden thing came. She proclaimed, as yes, the serpent came and convinced me of the harmlessness of this thing. It's tempting. Take, eat with me, as he did eat. Separation, hardship, incompatibility, neglect, war and fighting in generations, this world it did bring. Such unnatural things, they were put out of the garden. Oh, how soon to come things would change. Woman as day, as night is to man. Hard to find him the same ever again. Without heaven's blessings and bringing together of such things. The Fall and Clashing of Planets by Zelina Chardé. Thank you.
Hallelujah. The glory broken. Hebrews 7 and verse 20. Whither the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus, made an high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. We do a lot of Bible reading in this church, and through the study of God's word, we have learned God's original intent, a face-to-face relationship with man. Pastor just told us how sin separated man from God. But God had a sovereign plan for an interceder, Jesus, who would bruise the head of Satan, who would bruise his heel. The first interceder was Noah, who, through his faith in God, was able to begin again after the devastating flood that washed away a sin-sick world. The second interceder was Abram, the father of God's selection of a special people, the Jews, by a covenant that God made with Abram, who became Abraham. By God's order, through the loins of Abraham, the priesthood by Aaron was to intercede for the people who could no longer stand face to face with God because of their sinful nature. The priests, Aaron and his sons, designated the high priests, Merari, Kohath, and Gershon, were descendants of Levi, the great-grandson of Abram. They were the anointed spiritual shepherds of Israel. No one not descended from Levi could become a priest. But as we read through the Bible, we continually find that even the priests were sinful and had to cleanse themselves before they could sacrifice on behalf of the people. But here we find this fellow, Melchizedek, who comes to meet Abram after his victory in battle. You see, Abram defeated five enemy kings of Sodom and Gomorrah, who had kidnapped his nephew Lot. Abraham defeated them with 318 of his own men. We read in Genesis 14, verses 14 through 16 in the New Living Translation. When Abram heard that his nephew Lot had been captured, he mobilized the 318 trained men who had been born into his household. Then he pursued Chedorlaomer's army until he caught up with them at Dan. There he divided his men and attacked during the night. Chedorlaomer's army fled, but Abram chased them as far as Hobah, north of Damascus. Abram recovered all the goods that had been taken, and he brought back his nephew Lot with his possessions and all the women and the other captives. Now, I'm not going to get into how if you add 3 plus 1 plus 8, you get 12, meaning God's power and authority. But we have come to understand that God had a hand in Abram's life as he turned from the gods of his fathers and sought after God. So now, on his return from his victory, Abram meets Melchizedek. Genesis 14, 17 through 20 says, after Abram returned from his victory over Chedorlaomer and his allies, the king of Sodom went out to meet him in the valley of Shaveh, that is, the king's valley. And Melchizedek, the king of Salem, and a priest of God Most High, brought Abram some bread and wine. Melchizedek blessed Abram with his blessing. Blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. And blessed be God Most High, who has defeated your enemies for you. Then Abram gave Melchizedek a tenth of all the goods he had recovered. Who is this guy? And what is the significance of his appearance? The Bible says very little about Melchizedek, other than that he appeared to Abram, and the reference to him again in the books of Psalms and Hebrews. His name, Melchizedek, means king of righteousness, and that he is king of Salem, meaning peace. We are told in Hebrews 7, verse 3, there is no record of his father or mother or any of his ancestors, no beginning or end to his life. He remains a priest forever, resembling the Son of God. He's timeless without generations. He brings Abram bread and wine and blesses him by God Most High, who has defeated his enemies for you. And Abram gives him a tenth of everything he has taken in victory. Melchizedek was not a Levite. He had no lineage. And therefore, by law, he should not have been a king of righteousness.
Come on now.
Hebrews 7:5 says, now the law of Moses required that the priests who are descendants of Levi must collect a tithe from the rest of the people of Israel who are descendants of Abraham. However, Hebrews 7:3b says, he, meaning Melchizedek, remains a priest forever, resembling the Son of God. And not only is he a priest, he's a king. King of Salem. King of peace.
Yes.
Melchizedek stands outside of time. Outside, and actually before the law was even given. As he blesses Abram and receives a tithe from him, and not just from Abram, but the seed within Abram from the Levitical priests and kings who are to descend from Abram. That makes Melchizedek king of kings and Lord of lords.
Beautiful.
Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He is what we call a Christophany, a pre-incarnate manifestation of Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Hence, we find in the book of Hebrews 7, 16 through 17, Jesus became a priest, not by meeting the physical requirement belonging to the tribe of Levi, but by the power of a life that cannot be destroyed. And the psalmist pointed this out when he prophesied, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek.
Yes.
Beautiful. The psalm to which the writer in Hebrews is referring is Psalm 110, verse 4, in which the Almighty God speaks to Jesus and says, the Lord has taken an oath and will not break his vow. You are a priest in the order of Melchizedek. Just like Melchizedek, Jesus is our high priest, our King of kings. He took on our human flesh and dwelt among us that we as humankind might know him and live like him. But Jesus went further than that. Not only did Jesus take on human flesh, he laid aside the glory of heaven to come down and allow his flesh to be broken for us. Isaiah 53:5 says he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of his peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed.
Glory.
When I was given this assignment, the glory broken, immediately the saying came to my mind, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. But in this case, the perfect Trinity of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost would become broken at the cross. Even as the Father turned away from the Son, as the Son took on our sin. The cord that is not easily broken was broken in order that we, sinful mankind, created by God, could be fused back into relationship by the shed blood and the broken body of Jesus Christ, our high priest, in the order of Melchizedek. In closing, I must go back to the story of Melchizedek's blessing of Abram and note that in the order of reading, you know, we do chronological order, right? In the order of the reading, Melchizedek blesses Abram just before the king of Sodom comes to thank Abram for his defeat of the enemies of Sodom and offers to let Abram keep the spoils. But Abram refused. He he'd already received his blessing yeah. from the King of Kings Hallelujah. And the Lord of Lords and was not about to take anything from the world.
That's right.
Particularly from the king of such a wicked city, such as Sodom. Like Melchizedek, Jesus hung between the living and the dead, between salvation and the sinner. Brothers and sisters, choose Jesus and turn your back on what the world would offer you. Right. You will not regret it. Hallelujah to the
Hallelujah.
Lamb.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah to the Lamb.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God bless you. Wonderfully done. Melchizedek, before the law was grace. Come on, somebody. Oh, this is too much. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. The glory be hers. Be hers. Luke 1 and 35, it reads, "And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy being who shall be born of thee shall be called Son of God." Refresher. Heaven is all glory. The all-knowing, all-present, all-powerful Godhead is all glory. Jesus left this perfect estate to come to earth. Less than glory is the earth. Why? Because that's where we were and had fallen to. You cannot fall and be glorious. I tried once. That's how I hurt my foot for 8 months. Don't fall, be glorious. Hold yourself, girl. Oh, you're stronger than that. Should have just fouled. Oh, that traffic coming, I would have remained glorious. Should have just fouled. Huh? Because really, earning and falling, do you want to get up? All right. Yeah. I'm saying something there. Perfect glory would have to become imperfect glory to take imperfect glory, lower glory, human glory, and lift it up to the standard of heaven. There is a standard, folks. By the way, this is why when one accepts Jesus as Savior and Lord, there is now a higher standard living. You can't accept Jesus as your Savior and Lord and live in the same level of glory as you were before. Mm-hmm. This is why sanctification is constant, and it is a must. This fallen flesh can easily slip back into carnality. Don't fool yourself. Flesh has a wonderful memory. Oh, yeah, flesh has wonderful memory. Before you know it, you were doing well in church. Oh, you were so focused, but then you had a flesh back. Flesh back. And something awakened your carnality and you recognize, oh, I'm not as glorious as I thought I was. That's why we believe in sanctification. Every time we gather, we say, God, sanctify me. Oh, God, cleanse me anew. Wash me again with your blood. Because your blood doesn't fail. I fail. I fall. I falter. I'm flesh. But oh God, cover me today and let sanctification have its way, you see. So yeah, this flesh will take you back. I thought I wasn't gonna do that no more. I thought I had forgotten about that. Oh, I still feel that way. Oh Lord. That's why we believe in sanctification, church. Oh, you gotta come to the house. Say, God, clean me. Wash me. Make me. If you don't, I promise you, your flesh will have a memory and it will flash back.
You gotta keep Jesus before you. And this image of the flesh slipping back, that's not the image of holiness. Therefore, Christians seek our God in his sacred word to be found worthy of a form of glory now, and then we will experience the full glory later. You should look different. Somebody should look and say, it's something about you. That's the glory. It's an earthly shadow of the glory. How does the majestic, glorious one, the one full of glory, become a legal resident of earth? Well, this means that he will have to become man. Glory, full of glory, will have to become limited glory. Yay! He could have called 1008. Luke, I'll read it again. Luke 1 and 35, and the angel answered and said unto her, the glory or the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that glory being who shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. Pause it there. I hear you, Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost just said, when you have the glory, you know who you are. You're called a child of God. You don't go around doubting, you're strong, because the glory of God is now upon you. I return here in this verse is the agreement of conception by the Trinity. Now, in our limited mind, we can surely miss the miracle and greatness of this moment. You see, in order for me to have a child, all sorts of processes have to line up. It has to be the right time of the month, the right time of romance, because, you know, they don't always coincide, okay? The right time as ovulation and copulation and ejaculation must occur in order for fertilization to occur, and then implantation in the lining of the uterus, and then gestation as there is growth from the zygote to the embryo to the fetus to the baby. You see, we just think it happens. Open your legs, you're pregnant. No. A whole lot going on. We have no intimate clue of how this all happens after we have been intimate. Yet, with the omniscient Godhead, the only thing that had to happen was that there had to be a state of agreement. State of agreement. A mere human, Mary, had to come in agreement with the Godhead. Hear me well. If Mary did not come in agreement, it would have been rape. It would have been divine rape. A mere human Mary had to come into complete agreement with the Godhead for this thing to happen. Sidebar, there are some miracles that God has waiting for you and me. What is only truly needed is agreement. A legal contract emotionally, mentally, physically, and spiritually. God, your will be done. Let me read it again. Saying Luke 1 and 35, and the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore, also that holy being who shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. Church, look at this verse or hear it and understand the whole all power of heaven in glory is present. Don't miss it. The Holy Ghost is present. The highest, that's God, is present. The Son of God, Jesus, is present. Never has there been a more glorious act. The creative power that moved in Genesis would now move again. Let me read Genesis 1, 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Know this, if the Holy Spirit could move over nothing to create everything, there would be absolutely no issue for the same creative power to move over Mary, to have her ovum, to line up with the divine sperm, to place a fertilized zygote in her virgin womb. See, Holy Ghost? See, with humans, it has to enter a certain way. It doesn't matter what human you are, it has to enter a certain way. If it's natural, it has to enter a certain way. But listen here, church, and somebody's going to get it. With God, he'll work with you different. He'll work with you different. He'll work with you different. But it will be the same God, the same power, the same Holy Ghost that brings you to where you ought to be. He'll work with me the way he works with you. He'll talk to me the way he talks to you. He'll manifest himself. It's different, but it's the same spirit. That's why we must all gather together with one spirit. Worship God in spirit, you may clap soft. I may not clap at all. I may play the tambourine. You may clap your hands. But if we are all in the same building, experiencing the same glory, when all God's children get together, what a time, that's when miracles are happening. You don't even know, but I was in pain. I weren't feeling too well. But when we began to worship, all I know is that after church, I said, now, wasn't I feeling bad? But I don't even remember what I was feeling like. That's because in the midst of worship, God's holy creative spirit, God's all power moves over his people, and he takes them from one state to another estate. Give God glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Watch this. Just as in the beginning was an untouched womb of voidness, Mary was likewise an untouched womb of voidness. And one more time, there would be creation. The power of the Most High is the power of God. The power of God decrees a thing and it shall be. Hence, whether audibly spoken, what God deemed would be was so. The power of the Most High overshadowed in the creation process, and the same power of the Most High overshadowed Mary. Church, it was as if a divine canopy. If you've ever watched old shows of when, say, the king married the new queen, they had to consummate the marriage act in the presence of people in a canopy, a protective covering. Let me encourage somebody. What you've asked God for, I promise you, it's protected under a canopy. You seek God's presence and worship him and everything that he has for you. It's in the canopy of work. It's overshadowed. Okay. I'm not shaking. Mm-hmm. So listen. So the Most High would overshadow Mary. A divine canopy, that is, of the glory presence provided the intimacy. Enough and more intimacy. Oh, you get in me and you didn't get in me. Okay, divine. I'm just trying to tell you something here. It was at this moment that the divine glory in the form of sperm with divine DNA entered into the womb of a virgin. I know the world don't believe it. Of course not. It's madness. It's miraculous madness. I know it sounds ridiculous. Of course it does. Because it's God. If it made sense, I would understand it and mankind would have a patent on it. And charge. The glory of heaven was now in a sacred earthly place, the place that should be the most protected space ever, the womb. Mary now housed the glory of heaven, the glory of God within her. God chose Mary to carry. She agreed when she said this in Luke 1:38, because I got to show you where she agreed, because I told you there has to be a spirit of agreement. You want God's will done for your life? He's not agreeing with your will. He's saying you line up with his will. Don't give him something and expect him to bless it. You better seek him and know that the blessing is with you when you seek him. Luke 1:38, it reads, and Mary said, hey, behold the handmaid of the Lord. Be it unto me. Lord. Be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. Oh, the contract was written right there. They knew who Mary was anyway. They knew that Mary, she's an interesting one. It was plenty. Matter of fact, back in that day, all the little girls were virgins because that was the culture of the day. Not like today. Oh, Lord, not like today. But back in that day, oh, they it was going to be proof on the wet night. It was going to be a blood stain on the sheets on the wet night because that's how they got married, you see. Angel departed from her. Just as creation obeyed the command of God, Mary obeyed the command of God, and by the moving of the Holy Spirit, the work was done. Glory be hers. Consider this, newly dedicated, as Mary's song on that day. Lord, if I find favor in your sight, Lord, please hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately waiting to be where you are. I'll cross the hottest desert. I'll travel near or far for your glory. Just to see you, to behold you as my king, for your glory, I will do anything, just to see you, to behold you as my king, Lord, if I find favor in your sight. Lord, please hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately waiting to be where you are. I'll cross the hottest desert. I'll travel near or far. For your glory, I will do anything just to see you, to behold you as my king. For your glory, I will do anything just to see you, to behold you as my king. I wanna be where you are. I gotta be where you are. I wanna be where you are. I gotta be where you are. I wanna be where you are. I gotta be where you are. I wanna be where you are. I gotta be where you are. I wanna be where you are. I gotta be where you are. I wanna be where you are. I gotta be where you are. I wanna be where you are. I gotta be where you are.
be where you are. I gotta be where you are. For your glory, I will do anything just to see you, to behold you as my King. For your glory, I will do anything just to see you.
Your glory. Hallelujah. Will you do anything? Hallelujah. Thank you. Hallelujah. Just to see you. Hallelujah. They say I'm got 5 minutes. Let's do a Holy Ghost drive-by. Hallelujah. Well, my topic is glory bright. Glory bright. And a subtopic I have is glory preparation of the cross. Glory preparation of the cross. And our text is in Luke chapter 2, verse 8 to 11. And it reads, "And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them. And they were so afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." Well, in verse 9, which says, "And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around about them, and they were so afraid." Well, the angel of the Lord came upon these shepherds. We're in the field. They were out minding their own business. When boom, this angel appears. Just appears out of nowhere, amen? No ordinary angel. This angel stood before them and shone round about them. Because it wasn't an ordinary angel, it meant that this light that shone, it was bright, amen? It wasn't just some type of earthly light. But it was shining. It was the glory of the Lord. This was the Shekinah, a cloud of his brightness, which symbolizes the divine presence of God. Well, how many of you know the angel of the Lord, he showed up. Amen. He showed. Someone say he showed up.
He showed up.
He showed up. And when he showed up, he made all light look average. Just average light. Amen. Right? When he showed up, he showed up, amen. Well, someone say glory preparation.
Glory preparation.
Well, the glory preparation. These shepherds were afraid. Obviously, imagine yourself out in the field, out of nowhere, out of the blue. An angel shows up. I don't know about you, I might be a little afraid. He not only showed up, but the glory of the Lord begins to shine. His divine presence fills the place all around, amen. What would you do? What will you do with his presence? Mercy. This wasn't the first time, well, the angel of the Lord had showed up upon the earth. In Judges 13:3, And the angel of the Lord appeared unto the woman and said unto her, Behold, now thou art barren and bearest not, but thou shalt conceive and bear a son. Well, I remember another famous time. Showed up in Exodus 3 and 2. The angel of the Lord appeared unto him. Yeah? And the flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. Moses, yes. And he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire. And the bush was what? Not consumed. Hallelujah. What a glory. Amen. Well, in verse 10, it tells us, And the angel said unto them, Fear not. For behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. Not some people. Everybody say all people. For all people. And verse 11 says, For unto you is born, when? This day. In the city of David, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. The angel told them to what? Fear not. Well, easy for you to say. Some angel just shows up. Easy for you to say, don't be scared. Don't be scared. Hallelujah. Well, he came to bring good tidings of great joy. Yeah. He brought the good news, which was Jesus, who was going to be born this day. Amen. The glory preparation is now here. The Savior has been born, as the angel proclaims. From heaven, he was sent to be born of a virgin. Then he died on a cruel cross years later to fulfill the prophecy of the Bible. Amen. Someone say glory preparation.
Glory preparation.
Well, they whipped him. Amen. Say glory preparation.
Glory preparation.
Well, they put a crown of thorns on his head. Say glory preparation. Amen. Well, they hung him high and they stretched him wide. Glory preparation. Well, they put him in a grave. Someone say glory preparation. Well, he has the keys of death and hell, oh God, in his hands. Amen. Someone say glory preparation. He now sits on high on the right hand of God the Father, making intercession for us. Someone say glory preparation. Well, this light, it was a great light. It was the glory of the Lord. Amen. Well, I looked up this light. I said, let's see what's the brightest light around in the world. I looked it up and they said, this light that was so bright and long, I looked up and said, it's called a Laxo lamp. Well, this lamp can be found in Las Vegas. Well, this is what they say about this lamp. They said, this light is so bright that you can read a newspaper 10 miles away. From 10 miles away, you can read a newspaper with this light. That's how bright it is. Well, and even from up in the earth, in the sky, in the aircraft, looking down on a clear night, 275 miles up, this light can be seen. Well, somebody say one day. One day, hallelujah, we will stand around the throne of God. Hallelujah, to experience his glory. Hallelujah, it will shine brighter than this light. No more darkness, hallelujah. No more pain. No more tears, hallelujah. Someone say glory preparation. Hallelujah. Glory preparation. This glory preparation is for heaven. Hallelujah. It's not for now. Somebody say it's not for now. It's not for now. Glory preparation. Amen. There's a mansion prepared for you. Someone say there's a mansion prepared for me. Hallelujah. The glory preparation of the cross took place thousands and thousands of years ago on a hill far away. It said it's stored an old rugged cross. Amen. There was a thief on the right and on the left. Amen. That cross looked dark to some. But let me say, it was glory bright. Someone say glory bright. Glory bright. Amen. On that cross, there was one who rejected Jesus, as many would reject him today. Someone say, but. But, well, there was one who accepted Jesus, and he prepared for the glory. Someone say, glory preparation. Well, first thing you must do, let me tell you, someone out there and who is listening and don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, you must give your heart over to the Lord today, amen? It must be a preparation in place. Hallelujah. First, you must give your heart over to Jesus. Ask him to come into your heart. Someone say glory preparation. Well, we must now do unto others as you have them to do unto you. Someone say glory preparation. Well, then we must read and study God's word for ourselves. Not for once someone else says, take it and read it for yourself. Someone say glory preparation. Well, we must fast and we must pray. Someone say glory preparation. Then we must praise and worship and glorify God forever. Someone say glory preparation. Well, are you ready or are you prepared? Glory preparation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. We are being prepared. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. It's full of my lot. My scripture is taken from 5 minutes. So St. John chapter 11, verse 40 to 43, and it reads, Jesus said unto her, said I not unto thee that thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I say it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Today is glory believed. We've heard how glory fell. We heard how many people looked at glory and didn't think he was worth anything, didn't think it was going to happen. But when I looked up the word glory, from the Greek, doxa, which speaks to the nature and the acts of God, which was manifested through Christ. Christ, being God's son, was the only one that could manifest the glory of God. We couldn't do it. We needed the glory. Now, we know very well that many people during that day, they didn't believe that Christ was the glory. They just listened. They complained. They grumbled. It was only their seeing is believing. And it's no different today. We tell them about the glory of God. We tell them about how God can save. But they don't want to hear it that way. They've got to see it to believe it. Now remember, Jesus was divine, but yet he was human while on earth. But he also knew his purpose and knew his duty. Now, the story I've read was just one of the many miracles that Jesus did, but I looked at it. And as I looked at it, I said, you know, Jesus did three things there. He had an administrative faith. He had a relational faith. And then he had a divine faith. As an administrator, if any of you have ever been an administrator in a business, you know you have to make sure that things are kept in line. You have to make sure that things line up. You have to make sure that everything works in order for the boss, for the company. Jesus made sure that the work of creation, the work of redemption, was kept in order. So therefore, when he came for no other purpose but to fulfill his administrative faith.
Love that.
I looked at this and I went back a bit in St. John chapter 11. Now Jesus got the word that Lazarus was sick. He heard it. And I believe he understood it very well. But he didn't move. He didn't become perturbed. He said, this sickness is not unto death. And he knew that he had the power because of him being the glory of God to bring that Lazarus back. I just want to take 5 minutes, 5 seconds, because I've only got 5 minutes. Pastor Seaman gave me this topic, and I was like, okay, it's not unto death.
And you all know my story a week ago.
Yes.
What happened? Yes. It could have been death. But Jesus said, this is not unto death. And because of that, I'm standing in the presence today.
Hallelujah.
I said, God. But you know what I noticed? Everybody talked about death. Jesus never used the word death, you know. He used sleeping. He used it in more than one occasion. Jairus' daughter. They all came crying and boohooing all over the place. He said, she's not dead. She's sleeping. But they didn't understand that. And they were like, something's wrong with this man. Got to be. And yet Jesus took 2 days before he went to even see about Lazarus. And when he got there, his sister, the busy one I always call Martha, was like, Jesus, you're just coming? He's been dead 4 days. That interests me. 4 days, Jesus died and rose in 3 days. Jairus' daughter, we don't know the time, but I'm saying 3 hours, because by the time they travel from where they were back to the house, I'm saying 3 hours. Why 4 days? I had to go and look it up. www.aftermath.com gave me this information. 24 hours to 72 hours, all your internal organs decompose. 3 to 5 days, your body starts to bloat and the blood-containing film leaks from your mouth and your nose.
Mercy, mercy, mercy.
So you know Lazarus was good and dead.
Good and dead.
Good and dead. Good and dead. And yet, Jesus' skeptic stood by and said, well, what is he going to do now?
My Lord.
What he going to do now? How he going to fix this one? But they believed afterwards. Let me tell you why they believed. They believed because Jesus took his administrative authority and faith and said, roll back that stone. Just roll it back. I don't care what else you do, but roll it back. He then took his relational faith and said, Jesus said to his father, I'm praying to you, not for me, but I'm praying for these people because they don't believe you're going to do it, but I believe you're going to do it. And because of his relation with his father, who had already sent him down to be glorified in him, said, I'll glorify you. So then Jesus took his divine faith.
There you go.
And he said, Lazarus, come forth. Thank God he called him by name. It might have been something happening that day that they would have had to believe even if they didn't want to. And then I thought about it. I said, you know what? The same way on that Golgotha's hill, when Jesus said to that thief on the cross, today, thou wilt be with me in paradise. He used his divine faith there with that particular one. And listen, he also, they believed because of what they saw. If they don't see it, they would not believe it. But the glory had already descended in their presence. The same thing with Jairus' sister. They didn't believe. But after they saw what had happened, they then began to believe. And I know my text stopped at verse 43, but I had to go on a little bit further to verse 45. And verse 45 tells us that after they saw what happened, they believed on the glory
Many even today do not believe Christ or the work of Christ. The cross is our losing factor for us. That's how Lazarus was loosed. He said, loose him. The cross looses us. We were all born in sin and sick unto death. Yet, because of the glory of the cross,
thank you, Lord,
we who were dead and were made alive, according to Ephesians 2, 1 and 5, and Colossians 2 and 13. Now, I want you all to remember, you don't have to see to believe.
Right. Amen.
You just have to believe.
Yeah.
Believe.
Amen.
None of you came in here this morning and believed that those chairs were going to hold you. You just sat in them.
That's it.
That's the same way you believe. Not anyone hearing me today that do not know Jesus Christ.
Well,
you don't have to prepare yourself to be ready. Just believe on the glory of the cross. Christ is waiting for you and you and you.
Yeah.
Why? Because it's going to be done through the glory of the cross.
God. Amen. Amen. All right. Beautiful.
Jesus.
Right. Hey.
How many of you know that Jesus is a miracle worker?
Oh, yes,
hallelujah.
He is. Yes, he is.
Because the blood was applied, we cannot
That's
be
right.
denied.
That's
hallelujah.
Right. Come on
now. Jesus is a miracle worker. He healed the blind. He raised the dead. 5,000 hungry souls he fed.
Well.
He only had 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. He stilled the storm on the raging sea. He gave his life for you and me. He is a miracle worker. He walked on water and even turned water into wine. He did all of this in his short lifetime. He's a miracle worker. He healed the sick, even raised the dead. He did everything that he said. Miracle worker. He cast demons out of possessed souls. Can I tell you that Lord Jesus was bold? He performed these miracles for you and I. Now we need to do our part before we meet him in the sky. That's a reason to celebrate. Oh, help me, Jesus. We need to lead others to this miracle man. We need to all just take a stand. Let others know they can have eternal life too. For this is what he wants all of us to do. Yes, Jesus is still a miracle worker, for you see, he worked a mighty miracle in you and me. Jesus is a miracle worker.
Hallelujah. Jesus is a miracle worker. With all that we have just celebrated through the ministry of God's word, I now will speak from the heading or the topic, the glory belittled. The glory belittled. St. Matthew 27, verses 21 through 23. It reads, "The governor answered and said unto them, whether of the twain will ye see that I release unto you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate saith unto them, what shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ? They all say unto him, let him be crucified. And the governor said, why? What evil hath he done? But they cried out the more, saying, let him be crucified. Church, this is the Jesus that for 3 years healed sick. You know some of the famous miracles he did.
It is at this belittling time that I wonder, where is blind Bartimaeus? Where's the woman with the issue of blood? Where's Peter's mother-in-law? How about that Samaritan? Where's she at? How about the widow of Nain's son? The man that sat by the pool of Bethesda for 38 years. Where are all of those who were touched by the miraculous healing power of Jesus? These were people in whose eye Jesus was big. This same Jesus is now being belittled. Belittled as though every miracle was a crime. As though every life restored was an illegal act. Well, church, I do not have a definitive response. I don't know if the recipient of such miracles were in the hateful crowd or if they were hiding in their homes away from the crowd. What we are aware of is that Jesus was belittled. He was broken down, Lord have mercy, in the sight of man. He was castrated in the corridors of the hearts of mankind. He was annihilated in the actions of mankind. As it were, all of humanity were a witness against Jesus. Whereas riding into the city of Jerusalem, even the Pharisees said, the whole world is going after him. On this day, the whole world is against him. What kind of madness is this? They prefer Barabbas. Let me read the entirety of it, St. Matthew 27, 15 through 26. Now at the feast of the governor was wont to release unto the people a prisoner, whom they would. And they had then a notable prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, whom will ye that I release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus, which is called Christ? For he knew that for envy they had delivered him. The people had an attitude, like they can correct their attitude now, yeah. When he was sat down on the judgment seat, his wife sent unto him, saying, look, have nothing to do with this just man. For I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. But the chief priest and elders, persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus. Let me read that again to help some of you understand things. But the chief priest and elders persuaded the multitude, very persuasive, elders are very persuasive, that they should ask for Barabbas, destroy Jesus. We want Barabbas, destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said unto them, whether of the twain will ye that I release unto you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate saith unto them, what shall I do with Jesus, which is called Christ? They all say unto him, let him be crucified. And the governor said, why? What evil hath he done? But they cried out all the more, saying, let him be crucified. When Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude. He like that guy, it wasn't me. What he name? Shaggy, Snoopy, Shaggy, Shiggy, who? Him. It wasn't me. I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See you to it. Then answered all the people and said, his blood be on us and on our children. Then released he Barabbas unto them. And when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. Barabbas, let me talk about it, was a notable prisoner. In other words, he was a sure enough criminal. Like he was going to wake up every day and commit crime. Sure enough. Barabbas was the ultimate prisoner. Who is this Barabbas? Barabbas, his name means son of Abba or son of a father. Hold on. Is not God called our Abba Father? Mark 14 and 36, it reads, and he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what thou wilt. Barabbas also means son of shame, confusion. They preferred this man to be freed and Jesus to be found guilty. What kind of confusion is this? Well, it is the confusion of the day. That when Jesus, the Son of God, salvation, eternal joy, and forever with God and forever in glory is offered, people today are still preferring the shame of sin. Come on. Sadly, even as the Jews rejected Jesus, how many Christians will not darken the door of the church to honor the work of salvation by Jesus Christ? How many Christians are not in Shekinah today or will not be in any church today? So we look back on them and say, wow, they don't honor him. They just want to hear him crucified. And the question we have to ask ourselves, church, do we crucify Christ afresh? How many are teaching their children today that it is about a holiday? Take your time, Seaman. It is about flying kites, fish cakes, hot cross buns. It's about chilling. I worked all week. I'm taking a holiday. How many of us and we who call ourselves Christians are not in church today, won't be at somebody's church this afternoon, and you wonder why and how they could say, crucify him? I declare with boldness that today there are many who call themselves Christians who are crucifying Christ afresh and not worshiping Jesus for the work that he done on this day. You see, the crowd today is no different than the crowd then. How did they prefer to belittle Jesus? The same way we do today. They preferred Barabbas. We prefer Barabbas. Okay, he was a thief. We become thieves. No, Seaman, explain it. Going beyond that today, we are a criminal today, those that say, I've got time to be at home, to gather with relatives, to go to the field to fly kites, to do nothing, to clean my house, instead of coming into the house of God. You're a thief. We yet live in a confused state. They preferred a big-time criminal and to belittle a beloved Christ. The beauty of this moment is that today and on that day, all criminals, all in the same shame of sin and all confused by their own lustful desires. All the same, their own lustful desires are set free to choose Jesus. I can't make you come to church. I only can create the atmosphere, create the program, lay it out, have wonderful preaching. I'm having myself a ball today. But I still can't make you choose Jesus. And some, let me tell you, listen, Holy Ghost. He said, Maria, if they don't choose Jesus, it's only Barabbas. But then we want Jesus to save our children and our family. Yes. You're a thief. You're teaching the children, we're teaching our families how to steal time away from God, and yet we want to spend eternity with God, and we want them in eternity with us. Well, you know what? Be clear, church. You and I are all Barabbas. We are born in sin and shaped in iniquity, yet because Jesus was belittled and because Barabbas was preferred, this is the great message of love of God through Christ Jesus. The kingdom glory took on the kingdom of earth's sin and shame so that what was little on that day became much the next day. Little is much because God is in it. Where there's life, there's hope. A known criminal was set free so that you and I would be without excuse. No excuse. So that whatever crime of sin that we have done cannot condemn us to death. See, wherever we go wrong, we can't stay wrong. If you stay wrong, you say, Jesus, my wrong outdoes what you did on the cross. And yet we can't be like some religions and just say, well, I can do wrong and then I'm going to go to church the next day. I can do wrong and then I went, no. Jesus, the glory of heaven, took our shame so that we might gain life. Jesus loves us so much.
Jesus loves us all so much. Jesus loves us all so much that he would bleed and die. He took upon his beaten back the cross that saw him crucified. Yes, he loved us all so much that he was scorned and scoffed. He took it upon himself, for it was the will of God. God knew it was the only way, the final sacrifice. Jesus Christ, a sinless man, would need to give his life. And even in the gift he gave, we still have not yet known the fullness of his mighty love and the grace so freely shown. All he asks is that we repent and follow him. For he has made a way for us, free from hurt and sin. Yes, God loved us all so much. And yes, he loves us still. He longs for us to trust in him and to do the Father's will.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I Love You, Jesus by Caroline Falzone. When I look at you crucified on the cross, I come face to face with evil and sin. When I look at you abandoned by men, I just want to sing to you the best way I can. I love you, Jesus. I love you so much. Stay with me. Don't leave me. I want to love you until the day I die. When I look at you hung on the cross, I look into your face and see my friend. When I look at you forsaken by men, I feel sore to my bones, but forever in your debt. I love you, Jesus. I love you so much. Stay with me. Don't leave me. I want to love you until the day I die. When I look at you in pain on the cross, my heart misses a beat. Tears run down my face. When I look at you insulted by men, I feel your love inside me, your love with no end. I love you, Jesus. I love you so much. Stay with me. Don't leave me. I want to love you until the day I die. Amen.
Hallelujah.
The glory beaten. The glory beaten. Matthew chapter 26, verses 65 through 68. Then the high priest rent his clothes, saying, he has spoken blasphemy.
What further need have we of witnesses? Behold, now ye have heard his blasphemy. What think ye? They answered and said, he is guilty of death. Then did they spit in his face and buffeted him. And others smote him with the palms of their hands, saying, prophesy unto us, thou Christ. Who is he that smote thee? In these four short verses, Jesus is accused, attacked, and abased. After his betrayal and arrest in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus is put on trial. At the beginning of his trial before the Sanhedrin, when the chief priests, the elders, and all the council seek false testimony against Jesus and make false witnesses come forward, Jesus holds his peace and keeps silent. Even when the two witnesses claim that Jesus said he would destroy the temple in Jerusalem and rebuild it in 3 days, Jesus keeps his peace. For he knew, of course, that he had been misquoted. He had not been talking about the destruction of the city temple, but rather his own body. And so Jesus remains silent. The high priest, however, then brings up the most contentious statement Jesus had ever suggested in his teachings. And to compel Jesus to speak, the high priest treacherously invokes the formal oath, saying unto Jesus, I adjure thee by the living God, that thou tell us whether thou be the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus replies, it is as you said. Jesus knew, of course, what was to come. Indeed, this was the very fulfillment of his earthly mission, the very reason for the incarnation. Jesus had left his position of glory and humbled himself to be beaten and crucified for our sins. Isaiah 53:5, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. After Jesus replies, it is as you said, Caiaphas, the high priest, proceeds to accuse Jesus of blasphemy because he claimed to be the Messiah, the Son of God. Blasphemy is a religious offense wherein a person says or does something regarded as being disrespectful to God. In the eyes of the Jewish leaders, when Jesus claimed to be God's son, he was insulting God. Blasphemy was taken very seriously, and it was punishable by death. Jesus was accused and pronounced guilty of blasphemy. He was therefore deserving of death. So, accused and condemned, Jesus is then viciously attacked. Verse 67, then did they spit in his face and buffeted him, and others smote him with the palms of their hands. Spitting in the face was a sign of the greatest contempt and disdain that could possibly be shown. Buffet is from the Greek word kalaphizo. Buffeting, striking a person with the fist on the temples was one of the Greeks' most disgraceful punishments. And smiting with the open palm of the hand to slap, from the Greek raphizo, was considered such a dishonor that none but a slave ought to endure it. But Jesus endured it all. And he endured it all for us, for you and for me. Isaiah 50, verse 6, I gave my back to the smiters and my cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. I hid not my face from shame and spitting. Are we still spitting in Jesus' face today by denying him his rightful place as our Lord and Savior, as the one and only prophet, priest, and king over our lives? After he was accused and attacked, Jesus was then abased. The people taunted and mocked him, saying in verse 67, prophesy unto us, thou Christ. Who is he that smote thee? We know from Mark 14:65 that the people had also blindfolded Jesus. And so here they taunt and ridicule Jesus by asking him to see and name the person who has struck him. They sarcastically use the terms Christ and prophet and mockingly tell him to use his supernatural powers. How many people today deny the deity and power of Jesus? How many churches deny that Jesus is God? But here again, Jesus knowingly and willingly endures this ridicule, derision, and contempt. And he had even predicted it. And he had predicted as well his own death. Jesus says to his disciples in Matthew 20, verses 18 and 19, behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death, and shall deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify him. Jesus, accused, attacked, abased. The glory beaten. But thanks be to God, the glory did not end with the beating. Jesus concludes Matthew 20, verse 19 by saying, and the third day he shall rise again. Amen.
The glory of the cross. My small mind can't comprehend. My simple heart can't understand. My humble soul can't take it in. The glory of the cross. I'm grateful that you love me still and offer that your spirit will provide what I cannot fulfill to glorify the cross.
There is no one like Jesus. There is no one like Jesus, our Savior and Lord. The message is timeless, the price we could not afford. On the cross, he bore our shame, suffering, he died, our souls to reclaim. 3 days later, he arose from the grave, purchased our pardon. We are no longer enslaved. Yeah.
Well done. Yes, yes. Hallelujah.
The outcast. They called him fool and traitor as through the land he went. They cried out, agitator and brand of discontent. From altar and from steeple, upon this man forlorn, the priests and better people hurled wrath and cruel scorn. They called him cheat and faker and drove him from the door. They shouted, mischief maker, be gone and come no more. From border unto border, they hounded him lest he upset established order and bring on anarchy. At length, they seized and tried him that they might have their will. And so they crucified him upon a lonely hill. The outcast agitator, driven by scourge and rod, they called him fool and traitor. We call him Son of God.
With all that our Lord and Savior has gone through, having come to the earth through the womb of the Virgin Mary, having had a ministry among mankind, signs, miracles, wonders, being turned on, belittled, beaten, broken. Yes, glory bright, but now not looking so glorious. Yet, it does not end at the beating. I give to you the glory back. The glory back. Hey. Luke 23 and 46, it reads, and when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. What a magnificent, a magnanimous journey from heaven to earth to take us back to heaven. Yes, the consolation of humanity that receives Jesus Christ into their heart is that they will spend eternity in heaven, in glory. Now, folks, real. Even the sinners want to go to heaven. Why? In seemingly his most defeated moment, it was actually his most glorious moment. Church, let me take you back to a moment when the devil tried to get the glory from Jesus. You know, it is never enough with the devil. He led one third of the angels out of glory. Now, with Jesus having made it to earth to correct a work, the devil tries to abort the work before it begins. The devil believes in abortion. Remember this, Jesus being tempted in the wilderness? Matthew 4, 3, 6, and 8, and 9. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. And he said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and watch this, and the glory of them. And saith unto him, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Even
in his weakened physical state, Jesus is the Word. When you get tired, you still got the Word. When you're frustrated, you still got the Word. When it looks like you've been going through unlike any other time in your life, you still got the Word. So even in his weakened physical state, Jesus is the Word. The Word of God spoke the Word of God to command the glory to handle this time of temptation. Now, I said something, let me say it again. Even in his weakened physical state, Jesus is the Word of God. The Word of God spoke the Word of God to command the glory to handle this time of temptation. In other words, he said, glory be still. Because he could have turned the stone into bread. Glory hold back. I'm just beginning my ministry. Sometimes at the beginning is when you're tested, because the enemy knows if you get through, if you make it through, if you continue to stand, you will be a glory witness to the kingdom. And so the enemy does not want you to start right or end right. Now, church, how does this help you and me? Well, when we are weak in whatever way, if we would speak the Word of God into the situation, we would not yield to any temptation. As a matter of fact, let me say this. To yield to a temptation is to make Jesus a liar. And you know Jesus ain't no liar, so that makes you a liar. I couldn't help it. Yes, you could have. You could have. It was too much just at that moment. No, you could have. The devil lost in the beginning of Jesus' earthly ministry. Mm-hmm, yes, he did. Look at this. Luke 23, 35, 37, and 39. And the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, he saved others, let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen Son of God. 37, and saying, if thou be King of Jews, save thyself. Verse 39, and one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, if thou be Christ, save thyself and us. See, sometimes, let me talk to you a minute. Sometimes we're going through and we just don't want to go through. We want God to take us out of the situation. God is saying, if you go through the situation, you're going to get some glory out of your story. This is not the time to give up. This is not the time to give in. This is not the time to say, I ain't got to take, you know, I have to take this. And you know, take it. And watch your life go from glory to glory. Once again, there are three ifs designed to get a humanly weakened, physically drained, and emotionally dreary Jesus to escape the redemption hour by enacting the power of his glorious majesty. That's what the devil wanted him to do. Use your glory. Show him who you really are. And if Jesus had done that, he could not represent us. He had to represent us in order to win us to God. Oh, the devil wanted Jesus to kick into supernatural drive and cancel out the victory of dying for our sins. Yet the love of Jesus had and has for you, the love that he has for you and me, it kept him on task. Jesus, how do I know if you love Jesus? Oh, talk to him, Seaman. Oh, if you stay on task, then when you're going through your grievous moments, your moments where you quote, I'm hungry. I know you're hungry, Jesus. They're beating me. They're slapping me. I'm up on this cross. I can call 10,000. I know you can do all that. But you prove who you are when you can go through what you can go through and maintain who you're supposed to be. I'm still saved. I know. I'm sanctified. I'm Holy Ghost filled. I'm fire baptized. So no matter what life gives me, I'm going to give them back who I am for real. I'm staying on task. On that day, about midday, the glory of Jesus was beaten, bruised, and bludgeoned. Yet the attempt to destroy his glory only went skin deep or body deep.
They could only touch so much of him. There was a part of Jesus, his spirit being, that the beatings, the fists, the swords, the batons could not touch. That was the glory of Jesus. The glory of Jesus was still intact. Yeah, his spirit was pulled out. You know, I have a thought, and I'm going to investigate it, but I'll share it with you. You know, I wash chicken before I use it with vinegar and water, sometimes lime juice. Now that I've learned to do it, I do it, yeah? And once I wash it with vinegar and dry it off, I notice that whatever hairs are on the chicken, I can just pull them out easy. And God spoke to me over there. He said, yeah, that's why when he was offered vinegar, he said, no. You're trying to make things easy. But no, I want to make, things have to be as they have to be, because there are going to be some people in 2023, they're going to be going through rough situations, and I can't cop out because I don't want them to cop out when they're going through their tough situations. Hence, Jesus is about to go into the darkest location in existence, the death of the grave, he commands his spirit back to God. Yes. Understand, church, when you are a spiritual person in relationship with Jesus, death and the grave cannot contain all of who you are. That's why, especially old folks, you're going to have church at that home going. You're going to have church at that celebration of life. Because you're like, they're not here. The grave can't hold it. Oh, Lord. See, Jesus is our example. On the cross of Calvary, now carrying the weight of the sin of the world, God turns away from sin, away from his son. In this forsaken state, the final act of Jesus is to command his spirit back to God. God, I now choose for you to take my breath. Take the breath of life as I yield my life. Hold this life breath for me while I die for them. Jesus chose, he made a conscious decision to give his life and gain our lives through his sacrificial death. Jesus gave up the ghost. He gave up the earthly ghost, but his spirit was alive and well. He placed his spirit into safe hands. Talk to him right there, Seaman. Some of us place our spirits into hands that are not safe. And you wonder why you can't walk in total victory. Where have you placed your spirit? See, again, Jesus gave up the ghost. He gave up the earthly ghost, but his spirit was alive and well. He placed his spirit into safe hands so that the grave cannot touch his spirit. And because the grave cannot touch his spirit, you and I know that when this life is over, the spirit is alive and well in the hands of God. Whereas mankind's spirit, small s, is tarnished and tainted in the beginning, mankind's spirit is now perfected in the work of Jesus Christ. That's why on the cross he could say to that thief, you're going to be with me today in paradise. Your spirit has changed. So now your location after death is changed. You're going to be with me in paradise. Oh, that body, oh, that was some description. Whoever gave that body gonna, what? After 3 days and after 4 days, all types of bloating and what? I remember being at an autopsy and body made a sign. Lord have mercy. Just freshly married. Elder Seaman will tell you. He would sleep like this. I said, you can't sleep like that. You can't sleep. Remember that? I was tormented. I said, all I could see was the body and the more, and the cotton and
this man over here, I'm looking at him. No, you can't sleep like that. I got to get some rest. Oh, I look at you, I just see a dead man. Lord have mercy. But can I tell you that the reason why we can celebrate is because we know that after this life, life is just beginning. That like Jesus, we can say, Father, into your hands, I command my spirit. That when we sit around the bedside of a loved one that knows Jesus Christ, oh, they're leaving this earth. But I promise you, they're in a better place. Why? Because they know Jesus Christ. And we follow after Jesus because Jesus is the first fruit. And what he did, he said, that's what you're going to do. And so when you're on your way out of here, there is a there. Oh, used to be a time when Pentecostals understood that. By and by, when the morning comes, come on now, all the saints all gotta gather home. Tell the story how we overcome, and we'll understand it better by and by. That we live in a time when many don't know the reason for a Good Friday. It's a comfort reason, understanding that, listen, my spirit does not die. It lives on and on and on. Because Jesus gave his life on Calvary, we now will experience glory. The grave is no longer the same because glory entered that place and took possession of the victory it used to have. Death has lost its sting. And the grave has lost its victory. We thank God for the King of Glory.
King of Glory.
praise God as we have together presented a message that causes us to focus on the glory of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He went through all he went through so that when you go through and you go through and you go through, you can't stop at what you go through. Jesus got up, which means you must get up if you're following Jesus. And that's why the walk of a Christian is a victorious one. And that's why we must constantly read the word and study the word and understand it, because we have to appreciate it every time. Encourage ourselves by the word. And I want to thank you. This is our first time we've ever been together. And you've done well. God bless you. You've done well. Very proud of you. Because I believe that we took it and we understand that it's about Jesus. And when you give him your all, God bless you, director, as you have backed us up with the music and gotten on those keys when you needed to. When we work together, the work gets done. And so I am totally pleased as your pastor in what we have done. Just in case somebody out there, you're not saved, what better day to give your life than the day that Jesus Christ gave his life? We commemorate that day. Jesus is still real. Jesus is still, his blood as ever as powerful as it has been. And he can be your savior. To the backslider, come back home. To the hurt, the grieving, the belittled, the broken, all you people, all the church hurt people, come back home. And that's what the enemy does. Let me tell you, he makes it that you focus on your church hurt. I want to meet the person who has not been hurt by church. That's going to be a moment. Because people are people. Don't let the devil fool you into thinking it's about the church. It's about people. And when all the people, when we focus on the work on the cross of Calvary, nothing keeps us down. Church hurt becomes a testimony. So when you get to be a super senior, you tell these little ones, been there, done that. Got the t-shirt, the coffee mug, I got it. Now get up and let's go. Let's go. Hallelujah. Let's get up and praise God. Yeah, that's what we got to do, sis. Nothing can keep you down. Jesus got up. Lord, have mercy. He went through it because he knew you would go through it. He has already tasted of what you've been through. And he's shown us how to be victorious. So, Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for this time that we've had together in this way. And now, God, as we prepare for Holy Communion, be in the midst of us as we continue to commemorate your Son, Jesus Christ, in thanksgiving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.